people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect. The
yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
Welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin the headlines first. Deadly explosion hits luxury hotel in Pakistan. Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan claims responsibility. Sri Lanka marks second anniversary of the bloody Easter Sunday bombings. And week-long violent protests force Pakistan government to surrender before Islamists. Pakistan is a unique country in the sense that it itself has created and fostered terrorist groups and is now paying for its own deeds. The recent deadly attack at a luxury hotel in Quetta by Pakistan's homegrown terror outfit Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan has demonstrated that using terrorism as an instrument of state policy can backfire badly. But as usual, Pakistan is again blaming India for the blast which killed several people. Take a look.
A powerful bomb exploded in the parking area of a luxury hotel in the southwestern Pakistani city of Quetta, killing at least four people and wounding at least 11 others. Footage of the blast was shared on social media in the aftermath and it showed fire raging at the site. Hours after the attack, the Pakistani Taliban in a statement claimed responsibility, saying it was a suicide attack and that it had targeted police officers and other officials.
देखिए आज अफ्तारी के बाद ये वाक्या पेश आया है ये सरीना होटल के पार्किंग में खड़ी थी जिसके धमाके से तकरीबन अब तक चार अफराद हलाक हो गए हैं और 11 अफराद जख्मी हैं जिसमें हमारा एक पुलिस कांस्टेबल भी है
The Chinese ambassador to Pakistan Nong Rong was staying at the hotel but wasn't on the premises when the blast happened Initial reports had suggested that the target was China's ambassador, but the Pakistani Taliban did not mention the Chinese diplomat in its statements. However, after the deadly explosion, Chinese government also gave its reaction.
当地时间 4月21日晚, 巴基斯坦毗卢支省首府奎塔一家酒店发生汽车炸弹袭击，造成多人死伤。中方对这起恐怖袭击
Soon after the blast, Pakistan's Interior Minister Sheikh Rashid Ahmed pointed the finger at India. However, it is not new for Pakistan to blame New Delhi. Islamabad has always blamed India for disturbances in the restive Balochistan province, which has been the ground of a violent separatist movement for several decades. But now, instead of blaming India, Pakistan should take action against its own Taliban group, which poses a threat in the country and beyond.
Counterterrorism requires a very comprehensive approach at the national level, undertaken by all arms of the state. As far as Pakistan is concerned, they have got a national action plan on terror, which actually only exists on paper.
The Pakistan Taliban group has killed hundreds of people in suicide bombings and other attacks over the years. For a brief time after the Peshawar school attack of 2014, there was some clarity in recognizing the homegrown nature of the Pakistan Taliban, and the country devised a national action plan to tackle extremism and terrorism. But it has gone by the wayside as the Pakistani state has turned back once again to blaming India for terrorism in the country.
Forty-two years have passed since the start of non-stop imposed conflicts in Afghanistan. During this period, several attempts have been made to stabilize the country and to restore sustainable peace there. However, each peace effort has failed or stalled thanks to the Taliban and their regional state sponsor, Pakistan. The future of Afghanistan cannot be discussed without talking about Pakistan. It is a country that drives the conflict in Afghanistan and has always supported Taliban and its proxies. A report.
The attack on the Twin Towers in September 2001 remains saved in the memory of almost everyone, in response to which American forces entered Afghanistan on 26 September that year. Now US President Joe Biden has decided to withdraw all American forces from Afghanistan by September 11, 2021, the 20th anniversary of the deadly attack. The move effectively ends America's involvement in its longest war in history, but leaves Afghanistan teetering on a knife edge. Civilian casualties have been on the rise as the Taliban has ramped up its bloody campaign across the country. Inconsistent global powers, foreign politics, and indifference to Pakistan's Taliban sponsorship continue to frustrate Afghans and spoil peace efforts.
So Pakistan's involvement with the Taliban and its endgame, planned endgame, is absolutely clear. What they want is a chaotic situation to prevail so that, as happened in 94 and 1996, when the foreign forces, particularly the American presence, comes to an end in Afghanistan, they believe the Taliban will be able to march in practically unopposed and take over the country.
Pakistan has played on both sides of the field in Afghanistan, contributing to the Taliban's success. Taliban sanctuary in Pakistan and state support from organizations like Inter-Services Intelligence have been essential to their war effort, and the failure of the US to undermine this haven may be Washington's most significant mistake of the war. Recently, US Senator Jack Reed reminded this to his colleagues on the Senate floor. Islamabad, or more accurately, Rawalpindi's influence with the Taliban is the reason why Pakistan has a seat at the table when the future of Afghanistan is discussed. However, Taliban and Pakistan are hardly genuine peacemakers. Rather, they are both peace spoilers. According to US and Afghan officials, Taliban enjoy safe havens in Pakistan, where they receive arms, intelligence guidance, operational training, and ideological indoctrination. With such support, these fundamentalists continue to exploit Afghan and international peace efforts to gain legitimacy while escalating their terror campaign across Afghanistan. Recently, Canada's former ambassador to Afghanistan, Chris Alexander, also mentioned that Pakistan's proxy war was an impediment to restoring peace in the country. In an article titled "Ending Pakistan's Proxy War in Afghanistan," published in The Hill, Alexander expressed his views, saying that those in Pakistan still supporting proxy war in Afghanistan should face tough sanctions.
Donald Trump, the Trump administration, was more realistic, but the fact remains, the action that should have been taken against Pakistan, not just criticism, it should have been military action. It could have been covert action. You could have asked other countries to take covert action, including Afghanistan. That unfortunately was never taken. So what you have is this continuous effort by America to engage Pakistan, knowing fully well that Pakistan's intentions are not at all honest, that there is no position that Pakistan will uphold, even if it undertakes to uphold that particular position. And as a result of this, we have come to this sorry mess that is in Afghanistan.
ISI is working to form an umbrella alliance of deadly terror outfits across Afghanistan to ensure Pakistani domination in affairs of that country by exploiting these groups. The proxy war of this notorious agency has killed hundreds and thousands of people in Afghanistan. Meanwhile, the terror mongers and those who want to provide them safe havens gained importance in Pakistan's decision-making machinery. Islamabad should understand that supporting terrorism in Afghanistan and other countries has also had an effect on Pakistan. Hence, ending support to terrorism is in the interest of Pakistan itself.
Two years years ago, a series of coordinated attacks on Easter Sunday in Sri Lanka shattered the peace in a country that has suffered a long history of sectarian tensions. These tragic events rocked the nation and reverberated across Asia and beyond. Following the lethal attacks, there were revelations of security and intelligence failures, and the incident also disclosed that extremism is a much deeper and ingrained problem in Sri Lanka than most had realized. The nation recently marked the second anniversary of deadly attacks and remembered all the victims killed in the suicide blasts.
These people gathered outside St. Anthony Church in Sri Lanka are observing 2 minute silence on the second anniversary of Easter attacks. 2 years ago, Sri Lanka experienced the trauma of the Easter Sunday bombings that left at least 250 people dead. The explosions targeted Christians at Easter Sunday church services in Colombo, Negombo and Batticaloa and tourists staying in luxury hotels in capital. The world watched the mayhem unfolding in the Indian Island Ocean, which was still recuperating from the years of bloodshed and violence during the civil war. According to Sri Lankan government officials, all the suicide bombers in the attacks were Sri Lankan citizens associated with National Tawhid Jamaat, a local militant Islamist group with suspected foreign ties. The deadly attacks exposed multiple gaps in Sri Lanka's security architecture, and for many Sri Lankans, there are still unanswered questions which need to be solved.
We have to stress that what is happening at the moment, which is an attitude of no care, where all the factors are not properly investigated and in a coordinated and an organized fashion, but from day to day according to each day's fortunes, is not going to satisfy our questions.
The scale and coordination of the bombings indicated an advanced logistical capability and structure among domestic Islamist networks. A special pro-panel appointed in 2019 by former President Maithripala Sirisena had recommended the banning of Muslim extremist organizations who advocate radicalism in the Buddhist-majority country. However, the panel was then rejected by all political parties. But recently, Sri Lanka banned 11 hardline Islamist organizations in the country. Among the banned organizations are local Muslim groups, including the Sri Lanka Islamic Students Movement. From mulling burqa ban to de-radicalization law, the Sri Lankan government has taken several steps as part of a crackdown against Islamic extremism in the aftermath of the Easter bombings. But such steps do not reduce risk of future violence in the country. Sri Lanka has to re-establish its intelligence coordination. During Easter Sunday bombings, media reports suggested intelligence lapses, including a lack of information sharing between the country's intelligence agencies, the President and the Prime Minister. Colombo needs intelligence sharing with foreign partners to deal with its challenge.
Intelligence inputs, even if far-fetched, even if sometimes not very accurate, needs to be acted upon. You never know, because a terrorist only needs one gap. They have a surprise element. They can act anywhere and often with impunity because of the surprise element. It is absolutely important that all the countries in South Asia and at the global level, regional and global level, must work together to not differentiate between terrorists.
Sri Lankan government is also concerned that the banned radical outfits may create a terror hub in the island nation, which could have major implications for the southern Indian Ocean region. Hence, Sri Lanka seeks closer security tie-up with India to counter seaborne terror in the region. India, as a long-standing friend, has always helped Colombo in counter-terrorism cooperation, and both the countries are now working on the expansion of security partnership.
In Pakistan, Islamic fundamentalists are now the real rulers. They can control the state machinery from the streets. The recent violent protests by proscribed Tehreek-e-Labbaik Pakistan exposed once again the grave danger that radical Islamist movements pose to Pakistan. Extremists belonging to various jihadi outfits are now lawmakers in the country, and by accepting all their demands, the government is just giving strength to these hardliners. A report.
Tehreek-e-Labbaik Pakistan, an Islamist party banned recently under the Anti-Terrorism Act, staged countrywide protests demanding the expulsion of the French ambassador over a cartoon of Prophet Muhammad published in France. Consequently, week-long violent protests forced the Imran Khan government to announce that a resolution will be introduced in the National Assembly on the expulsion of the French ambassador to Pakistan. Moreover, TLP chief Saad Rizvi, who was arrested on April 12, was also released. Surprisingly, such decisions came just after declaring Tehreek-e-Labbaik as a terror outfit and banning its activities across the country. It is the latest in a long series of surrenders to the Tehreek-e-Labbaik Pakistan group and its radical agenda.
حکومت پاکستان اور تحریک لبیک کے درمیان طویل مذاکرات کے بعد یہ بات طے پا گئی ہے کہ ہم آج قومی اسمبلی میں فرانسیسی سفیر کی ملک بدری کی قرارداد پیش کریں گے اور تحریک لبیک سارے ملک سے جس میں کہ خاص طور پر مسجد رحمت للعالمین سے بھی دھرنے کو ختم کیا جائے گا اور بات چیت اور مذاکرات کا سلسلہ آگے بڑھایا جائے گا اور جن لوگوں کے خلاف مقدمات درج ہیں سمیت فورتھ شیڈیول کے ان کا بھی اخراج کیا جائے گا
It seems that in Pakistan, religious hardliners can make lawmakers alter laws according to their interpretation of Sharia. They have proven that they do not need electoral success in Pakistan and they don't need to sit in parliament to make laws and govern the country. These Islamists are strategic assets that the military establishment uses to keep the civilian government under pressure. Moreover, the civilian government in Pakistan is also engaged in a cycle of appeasement politics. Prime Minister Imran Khan, as opposition leader, had tangoed frequently with various hardline religious outfits, including Tehreek-e-Labbaik Pakistan. He presented himself to the electorate as a devout Muslim, ready to come to the defense of Islam. Now these same radical groups have come to haunt him.
If you look at the state of internal turmoil in Pakistan, it is quite evident that terrorist is a snake and terrorism is a venom and the snake can bite the sponsor anytime. Pakistan started off with radicalization, with Ziaul-Haq, starting off with Islamization and President Musharraf calling them as strategic assets, trying to use it against various neighbors, including India, as proxies. They have used terrorists to their advantage, not realizing that when they become strong, obviously they will start dictating terms.
Having pandered to the religious groups in the past, Pakistan is now paying the price for encouraging these fringe elements. The government is fearful of chaos on the streets and the street power of the mullah. It is a frightening situation in Pakistan, not only for religious minorities, but also for the majority Muslims. Pakistan has entered an era in which religious hardliners have more power to dictate their decisions from what is Islamic to what is not, and who is an infidel, a blasphemer, a sinner, and a Western agent. Pakistani Islamists have demonstrated that they are the state now. The Islamist victory is Pakistan's defeat.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views, and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Uzma Jafri signing off on behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.
subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.